As we stroll along together, holding hands, walking all along.
We're in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and I'm going to take you back almost 5 decades, 50 years. I'm with two of my old buddies here, Al Caesar Berry and Norman Burnett. They're two of the original singers from the Tymes. And they brought me here because they want to tell you their story, their history. Now tell me guys, where are we? Where did you take me? Where did you bring me?
Well, this is where we record our first song, So Much in Love.
Where are we? What street is this?
This is 12th and Race, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Right.
And what happened here?
Well, it wasn't like it. Like it's looking now. Okay. It was another building by the name of Rekawart.
Mm-hmm. But what is Rekawart? How do you spell Rekawart?
Rekawart was spelled back in the day R-E-C-O-A-R-T.
And what did they do?
And it
here?
Was an old broken down warehouse at the time.
Really? So what was inside when you went inside?
A recording studio. I mean, the plaster was falling off the wall. It was just a engineer had a 24-track table, etc.
Who was the engineer?
Joe Tarsia. At the time.
Okay.
And he was just starting off, as a matter of fact. But he was a great man. He went on for bigger things, too. But this building here, we're in front of him now, was Rekawart at the time, and now it's been recording by everyone in the country.
Now, what do you mean everyone in the country? Who else recorded here besides the Tymes?
The OJs, Teddy Pendergrass, Chubby Checker, Dee Dee Sharp, the Dream Lovers.
Now, the Dream Lovers.
Right.
Who were they?
Dream Lovers were a group from Philadelphia. Matter of fact, they were my next door neighbors.
Is that right?
Right.
Lafayette
right.
lived next door to you?
No, Lafayette wasn't with him at the time.
Okay.
He was the original member. He wasn't born yet.
Wasn't
yeah.
Born.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
But Ray Dunn and Cliff Dunn, the two brothers, lived next door to me. And I used to sit on my doorstep and I used to watch them when they came home from different engagements.
Now they backed up Chubby Checker.
Right, on the twist.
The twist.
Right, right.
So their
right.
voices heard worldwide.
Oh, yeah.
Round
oh, yeah.
and round
oh, yeah.
and round. That's
oh,
them.
Yeah. That's yeah. them.
They
that's
recorded
them.
Here.
Right on. That's it. Yeah.
Who else recorded here?
Oh, man.
Jackson 5,
right, right.
Joey Heatherton.
Right,
yes, he
right.
Neil Sedaka.
You name them, they did it here. Because Sigma
well,
Sound.
You name them. Tell me more.
Right.
Neil Sedaka recorded
background
here too?
For Neil Sedaka.
Right, 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 right.
The Sky Above.
Sky Above.
A little known song.
Yeah,
it
okay.
made a little noise.
Yeah.
But you want it today.
Joey okay. Heatherton, what did we do with her? I forgot the name.
Live and Learn.
Live and Learn, right.
And with Lynn Barry. Once
right, Lynn Barry, we back. That's.
Now, Len Berry, he sang with another Philadelphia group, didn't he?
The Dovells.
The Dovells.
The Dovells.
Okay.
That's right, right.
And you backed him up on 1, 2, 3.
Right, right, right. That's right.
And
that's
that
right.
was written by right. Dave White.
Dave White and
Johnny Madero.
And they wrote At the House.
At the House. That's right.
Okay. Well, all of this is cross-pollinated. Yep. All of this is interrelated.
Right.
None of this stuff just dropped out of the sky.
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
This stuff, everybody worked with everybody. Everybody built off of yeah. your neighbor. Everybody
right,
built
right.
off of everybody else.
Right, right, right.
And it was
right.
all done here.
All done here.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
right.
Okay.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. So tell me now, the time. Mm-hmm. You guys were just young kids. And where were you going to school? Did you know each other in school? Or how did you meet?
Norman,
well,
yeah.
Back in 56, we was in a camp called Cottage Settlement Farm Camp. They used to have talent show. Well, we all... You know, everybody comes and you meet everybody from different neighborhoods and everything.
Mm-hmm.
So they had a talent show, either Saturday or Friday night. I can't remember now. It's kind of
how old were you?
Yeah. Oh, about 13.
13
yeah.
years old.
Yeah, yeah. yeah. And it was due to talent shows. And so after the camp, I said, let's keep this stuff going. Let's keep it going, right?
Mm-hmm.
So when we got out, it was me and George Hilliard. George Hilliard, he's still around. He's a preacher now. He's a deacon.
Well, he was one of the times.
Right.
The original.
And I got to see.
Mm-hmm.
C brought a Donald Banks in,
right.
which is George Hilliard's cousin.
Right.
And I found George Williams. He's working at a hospital, Albert Einstein Medical Center. I heard him singing. I was walking by the kitchen. I said, whoa.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's how he got there.
But matter of fact, Donald Banks lived in the same, right up the street from me. We lived in the same block. We knew each other since we were 10 years old.
Yeah.
And he was the original bass, the singer of the group, Donald Banks.
He just died last year?
Just died last year, yeah. Yeah, we were good friends. We were very good friends, very close. Yeah.
Do you think that if we went over there that we could get inside the studio where you did all this recording?
Be glad to.
No problem.
It'd be my pleasure.
Yeah.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Okay.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, this is it.
This is where it all began.
This is it. your old home.
Where it all began.
And we're inside the old studio. What did it look like when you guys walked in here when you were 20 years old, 50 years ago?
Well, remember that this wasn't like it is now.
I know.
But it was a storefront before. You walk up the steps, they had these chairs laying around, old chairs, and it was just a dusty old place.
And actually, this part of the building was Harry Chippett's office. He was the
president
at the time of the company. Yeah, and this was an old warehouse.
Okay, so they walk in old warehouse, but there had to be recording equipment in there.
Oh yeah. In the studio.
In the studio, in the back.
Right,
okay.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And how about musicians? Were there musicians already here, or did you have to bring your own?
No, they had
the musicians. Yeah. Right, they had. Philadelphia. We had members from the Philadelphia Orchestra.
So how did that make you guys feel? You're just, young kids.
But Billy Jackson was our producer at the time, and Billy Jackson, he used to sing with a group called the Revels back in the day. They made Cha Cha Tony, Dead Man's Scroll, etc. And he was the head of the A&R department of Cameo Parkway, and he brought us in. We auditioned for him. He brought us in, and then the musicians matter of fact, we had Tommy Bell played pianos for us sometimes, Bob Eli, Roland Chambers.
Now, Tommy Bell, he went on to play piano and produce.
For
what other groups?
Oh, yeah.
He played piano for us.
Yeah.
Stylistics.
Matter of fact, when we first started, our band that traveled with us, well, our band that we worked with with Kenny Gamble and the Romeos. That was Norman Chambers, Roland Chambers, Tommy Bell. Who else was on there? I forgot who else was in it. But Tommy Bell, he had said he was going to go to school and start learning how to arrange. And we laughed at, man, come on, but look at him today. But we were still good friends.
What
he did with the stylist.
Right, so you get over here, and are we talking in the spring of 63?
Mm-hmm.
Before you recorded So Much in Love, did you walk in here with the intention of recording that song?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh,
yeah.
So you knew it. It was all rehearsed.
Oh, yeah.
And it was a nice song, but you had no idea that it was going to endure for decades and decades, or for that matter, that it was going to go to number one in June of 1963.
Yeah. Matter of fact, it was called As We Strolled Along first. And then, with the expertise of the arrangers and Billy Jackson, they learned, they put the hooks in, So Much in Love, I Love You, and so on. And it materialized as a great song. George Williams brought it to us when we rehearsing in my basement on Wellington Street, when we're next door, like I said, to the Dream Lovers. And we rehearsed, and I got a nice song, man. And we listened to it, and I'm like, okay, because I wanted to rock and roll.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I had no idea that that song would be a hit record. No idea whatsoever. due to the public and, good promotion and things like that, just became a monster.
Just the fact that it was great.
It was a great song.
You can't hide.
Right, right.
I always say, good music you listen to, great music you feel.
Mm-hmm.
You feel that song.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a song you can put away and forget about.
Mm-hmm.
I heard it once and it's
as
the record charts showed in June of 63, that was the most bought record for that week. Everybody wanted that song.
That's right. It was a good song. But like I said, I had no idea. And I'm laying in the bed and I'm hearing people walking past my window singing it. And I'm like, is that my song they're singing?
How do you feel when you first heard it on the radio?
Oh, man. But I had no idea.
And you had to be a star.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
your voice was all over the nation and really around the world.
Mm-hmm.
And it will remain that way
for years
to come.
That's right.
Who came through these doors? Who recorded here other than the Tymes?
Back when we started?
Anytime at all.
Jackson 5.
Well, the Jackson 5, you say, recorded here.
Mm-hmm.
What did they, do you remember what they recorded? But what years? Well, that was back early
in the
70s?
With Gamble and Huff, yeah.
Put a Temptations, too.
Temptations. Right.
Now, when did the Temps, what did the Temps record here?
Well, at that time, they were changing members and stuff. Mm-hmm.
Do you remember, was Dennis with them at that time?
Dennis. The rest of them,
Maybe even Damon Harris. Papa was a Rolling Stone.
Damon Harris. That's the name I was trying to think of. He was with him.
Because at that time, Sigma was the place to come. But then when we were coming in, you look at people like Bobby Rydell, Dee Sharp, Chubby Checker. Wait,
Bobby Rydell recorded too?
Right, right, yeah. Right. Matter of fact, he even recorded So Much in Love. He did it. Yeah, you know, it didn't really reach it like ours did, but he what you say, covered it.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. Like I said, Bobby, Dee Dee, Chubby.
Now, wait, you're going so fast.
He's fast, man.
You're jumping down records.
This stuff is coming to
American
me.
American history
you gotta
so
watch
fast.
It. You got to watch it. You know that?
Let's talk about these names. Dee Dee Sharp recorded it.
Oh, yeah.
What did you do? What's your Mashed Potatoes?
Mashed Potatoes. What other things you did here?
So Twisted.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Chubby. Let's see, what else? Shoot. Just about everything she did came out of Sigma, you might say. Dovell.
Dovell, before Lenbury left them, they recorded them.
Yeah, Bristol Stomp. Mm-hmm. Yeah. They were with Cameo Parkway.
Right. Now, Cameo Parkway, they didn't have their own recording studio?
Yes. Mm-hmm. At that time, they didn't.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Right.
At that time.
So at the beginning, when Cameo Parkway was just starting out, they didn't have a recording studio, so that everybody sent every recording artist here.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But this was it. This was it for Philly, mm-hmm. I think. To me, this was the spot to come.
Yeah.
You know, really. Yeah, this was the spot to come. I mean, then as it grew and grew and grew and grew up to what we're seeing today.
Now, after you did your recording at Sigma Sound here, mm-hmm. or Recal Arts, you went. Any other places here in Philadelphia to record? Any other studios that play a role in the history of the time?
Yes, well, 309 North Broad.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no, what is that?
That's Cameo Parkway. They bought the building years later after we started, you know, making some money. Everybody started making money, so they decided to buy a building.
Now, Cameo Parkway, that was a big record label. Mm-hmm. And Parkway was the record label that the Twist came out of.
Yeah, yeah.
And Cameo, you guys were on Cameo.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Can you take me over there?
Take you over there right now.
Okay.
What is it? It used to be called the Schuster Building.
This is it here?
Yeah,
famous
this is
Schuster
it right
building?
Here.
230 South Broad Street.
Right.
That's right.
Tell me what happened here.
Well, we got discovered here. That's when we came for the audition, and this is where it all started.
Mm-hmm.
But behind Albert Caesar Berry over there.
Mm-hmm.
So how did you guys get to this location? You were just young kids.
Mm-hmm. Well, see, can tell you that.
But they had a what they called a talent contest here in Philadelphia. It's called the Tip Top Talent Hunt, and that make a long story short.
Tip Top. Now that's a
that was a bread.
Bread.
That was a bread.
Okay.
That was a bread.
Wow, were you guys singing for bread?
They sponsored the contest. You would make an audition tape, sent it in the WDS radio at the time, and the people, if they wanted to vote for you, they would take the seal and put the name of who they voted for, the artist, on, and send it in.
In order to vote for you, they had to buy a loaf of bread.
Right. And what happened, we never made it to the finals, because a gentleman named Leroy Lovett discovered us at the State Theater in West Philadelphia. Yeah. And he said, I know a guy that might be interested in you fellows
So basically, he pulled you right out of the contest.
Pulled us right out of the contest, right.
I'm glad he did.
Me too. Me
we
too.
Were
yeah, we were terrible.
We
were terrible.
We made it.
So you didn't think, it's kind of like an American Idol, okay? Uh-huh. Maybe you wouldn't have won the contest,
right.
But you'd have gone on to become
Right. It was really a funny thing, because we made this audition tape with the song we sang with Danny Boy. It was a Danny Boy.
Yeah, yeah,
that was
yeah,
the worst thing we ever did in our life to me.
We started too low.
Yeah, yeah.
And we had a part in there that said, oh, Danny Boy. No. Welcome
me back.
We said,
That was terrible. But anyway, Leroy Lovett, and he sent us down to Cameo Parkway and told us to check and talk to a gentleman named Billy Jackson. And we went down, we met Billy. And we auditioned, it was about maybe 10, 12 songs, a cappella. And So Much in Love was amongst that bunch.
At this building here,
230 South Broad, a little back room.
So here's what you're saying, you really auditioned.
Auditioned here.
With So Much in Love, right here.
Right here, that's right.
Not knowing
that was going to be the one that was going to be picked.
Yeah.
So make a long story short, I was sitting home one night and I said, well, I'm going to call up Billy Jackson to find out what happened.
Weeks went by.
And nobody called. So I called up Billy and I said, hey man, I wanted to call you to find out what happened. He said, man, we've been trying to contact you guys for the longest times. I lost your phone number. He said, come down right away tomorrow, the next day or whatever it was, and we want to record. I said, record what? He said, that song you guys auditioned, So Much in Love, As We Stroll Along. I said, okay.
That was it. Where did that song come from?
What really happened? George wrote it, but we all added things to it.
Right, right.
But George, you talk about George Williams.
George Williams.
He was a member. He was a member of the Tymes.
Right.
He wrote
So Much in Love.
So Much in Love.
Which was your biggest hit, your number one hit.
Right.
It really got you on the road to stardom. It all came from within.
Yeah. Right.
You really didn't have to go without.
Right. But at the time, Lee Andrews and the Hearts were big at Cameo Parkway at the time. And they wanted to give the song to Lee Andrews and the Hearts. they wanted to give the song to Lee Andrews at the time because we were known. We weren't known then. We were unknowns. And George said, if we can't record it, no one's going to record it.
Now, you told me about B09. Now, what is B09?
That's an old Cameo Parkway building.
And where is that located?
Right
around the corner from here.
Will you show me where that is?
Yes, we will.
Take me there?
Yeah, take me there.
Let's go. So what happened here?
Everything good, everything bad.
Well, tell me what you mean by that.
Well, everything was good. I'm going to get about the band. Everything was good. We did a lot of live recordings. Back then, you did live recordings with the band actually playing.
Everybody together at one time, if anybody made a mistake, started over again.
That's right.
Okay.
But the musicians were so good, though, there was too many mistakes. It was just brushing up, you might say. But you had a lot of good memories in this building, and like I said, Philly International's here now, but Cameo Parkway.
What's Philly International?
Gamble and Huff, the home of Gamble and Huff.
Okay.
Philly Sound.
This is where it all came from.
That's right.
Smooth Philly soul.
There you go.
Okay,
you
it all came out of
there
here.
There you go. There you go.
Now we're
luckily we weren't on that label at the time, but I would.
Are we talking Delphonics?
Delphonics, Stylistics.
The Intruders recorded out of here.
Right.
I always love my mama.
Right, that's Phil it. Simon. That's it. Phil Simon. That's right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Teddy Pendergrass. We said him. They're right there.
The Blue Notes. How about the Blue Notes?
Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes. And when it was Cameo Parkway, what's that? With the Mysterians.
The Mysterians. Yeah, he was the last group that recorded for Cameo Parkway.
Yeah. Who else recorded? Clint Eastwood.
Clint Eastwood, right. And one of the first, Charlie Gracie. Cameo Parkway.
Charlie Gracie.
Yeah, good friend.
Now he's going to be on the show, Pete's show, next week in Uniontown.
Right, in Uniontown. That's right. Yep. So like I said, a lot of good memories, a lot of famous people walk through these doors, and a lot of not-so-famous.
Now, when we talk about Philly International, we're talking, I know Little Anthony recorded for Philly International for a little while. The OJs.
Right.
They recorded here. They did Love Train was recorded in
Love Train, right. Archie Bell and the Drells. Right.
We're from Houston, Texas.
That's right.
We not only sing, but we dance.
That's it.
They did that all that here.
And matter of fact, before Little Anthony did that song, The House on the Corner, what was it? It was given to us at first.
Really?
Tommy Bell played it for us on the piano and wanted us to do it, but Little Anthony recorded The House, Loneliest House on the Block or something like that.
Yeah.
And Tommy Bell played it for us here, you know, really. But it didn't take, you know, for some reason. Plus, Tommy played a lot of songs that the OJs did, but they said George sang too pretty.
Yeah.
It wasn't rough enough. So the OJs recorded a lot of stuff that we, you know, not left alone, but we heard them first, I'll put it like that.
The Tymes were at the top of the charts. The Tymes were on American Bandstand, weren't they?
Yes, that's right.
When was that?
That was 63.
June of 63.
June of 63, right. That's when you guys were number one.
That's right.
So how was American Bandstand? Do you like that?
Oh man, it was great. Dick Clark, once you hit American Bandstand, you were on your way. Because Dick Clark broke all the records that came out of Philadelphia just about.
Now, where's American Bandstand from here?
It's not that far away. About a few blocks, but we can walk it.
Can you show it to me?
Oh, yeah.
Definitely.
Come on.
We'll take you there. Come on.
Now, where did you guys bring me? Where are we?
Oh, Dick Clark's famous bandstand was.
Hey.
This is it?
Yeah.
This is where American Bandstand took place?
46 in Market, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. That's right.
Was that show live or was that show taped and then broadcast?
It was live.
It was live show?
Live show.
No.
used to have kids standing out here waiting in line to get in, the dancers. They had certain dancers they let in, and you know, they kept them out in front of the cameras, but it was a very popular show in the day. And if you made American Bandstand, your record was a hit maybe the next day.
Now,
I'm telling you.
You guys were here in June of 1963. How many times did you appear in this show?
Three times.
Three times. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right, yeah. Yep, that's right, yeah. Remember that.
And you appeared, your music was published on Cameo Parkway Records.
Right.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, didn't Dick Clark have some ownership in that company?
Yes.
He got a piece of the publishing on everything that came out.
Everything that came out.
He's a very good businessman.
Yeah.
Very good businessman.
But he had to stop when the payola thing came out.
You know, you don't talk too much about certain things because you try to make everybody think that the business is so fabulous. But this is, you have to love it, I'll tell you like this. Because you don't get rich, but you've got to love what you do. And as long as we've been doing it, going these 50 years now, we're still doing it, that's from love. That's just what it's all about.
Yeah, it's all about.
You can see when you guys are on stage, it's obvious you guys enjoy it. Mm-hmm. When that music starts and you guys go out there on stage, it's like geritol. It's like,
believe me.
It's like a bottle of the fountain of youth.
Believe me.
If that's the way you want to put
believe
it.
Believe me. Yeah.
But you really enjoy what you're doing.
Oh, yeah.
You see. Mm-hmm. You didn't grow up in this neighborhood.
No.
But you grew up here in Philadelphia.
Right.
So you grew up on the other side of town.
Mm-hmm. North Philly.
North Philadelphia.
We're on West Philly now.
We're in West Philadelphia.
Okay. Yeah. So if this were 1 o'clock, we'd be at 9 o'clock. You guys grew up at 12 o'clock.
12 o'clock. There you go.
Okay. Mm-hmm. But just the fact that this was your hometown, and this went out to the entire nation, you guys had to be really excited.
Oh, yeah. It was a lot of fun. And we really accepted, you know, like I said, Dick Clark did a lot for the music industry in Philadelphia. And if your record hit Bandstand, you were going.
He had the tour was called the Caravan of Stars.
Okay.
We had a few buses, we had 3 buses, sometimes 2. You know, all depends how many acts was on the show.
But it was a caravan.
Going down
the road. It was loaded with the top performing artists and recording artists at that time.
Good times too, believe me. Really good times. Yep.
Did you go down south?
Oh yes.
We did most of the things down south.
Oh yes.
Now for young guys coming out of the north, going down south. why do you laugh? What did you learn? What was different?
It was different, you know. When we would go to get something to eat, one time I went in a restaurant, stood up in front.
What year are we talking, Norman?
We're talking about 64, 65.
Okay. I went to get something down south. I don't know if it was Little Rock. I think it was Little Rock.
Yep.
Damn. And I walked and I stood up there for about 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. I said, hey, nobody wait on me. They said, oh, you have to go around the back. And we'll wait on you back there. I said,
well, you're smiling now.
Wasn't funny then.
I said, what are you talking about? So I left. I would look for another spot. I walked 2 blocks down that way, 3 blocks over to the left. And I said, whoop, I had to come back. I stood in the front and said, where you want me to stand?
But then we did.
I get something to eat. That's the only way I can get something to eat.
Yeah, then we did eat at one restaurant. And Len Barry was with us. A whole bunch of us were there at this one restaurant. And as we're going out the door, the proprietor comes back and he says, hey, look. And he took and broke every glass, every dish, through every knife and fork on the floor.
That you guys used.
That we used. Not just us, but the white artists too.
Were
with us. Oh yeah. Because they didn't, even when we went into a place, I went in to get some hamburgers at a step by. We were in Birmingham, Alabama. Dick Clark got us and told us, go in and get the hamburger. I went in and ordered some hamburgers, et cetera, et cetera. And the guy pulled a shotgun from behind the counter and put it in my face. And he says, we don't serve no N-words in here. So Dick Clark goes in afterwards to order the same thing. And he said, we don't have no so-and-so lovers in here. They wouldn't serve him either because he was on the same bus. It was rough.
We were in Georgia, Peachtree Hotel.
Yay!
Peachtree, across the tracks.
Motel.
On the other side.
Right.
The white and the black side.
Right.
We went to the wrong one, went to the white side. So we walking up the steps. I was right behind Dick Clark. We was calling Richard. So we walking up the steps.
And they say, ho, ho, we don't allow y'all, you know. And Dick said, well, I'm Dick Clark, I don't care who you are. You got the wrong Peachtree Hotel.
Yeah.
You're looking for a Peachtree Motel
across the tracks. But what's so funny about that situation, last year we went back to Atlanta, Georgia, and we won a concert there. And we pulled up in front of the Peachtree Hotel. They came out and carried our bags in. This year, 2012, 10 or 11. Yeah, and they carried our bags in, you know. I mean, they were like, can we help you, sir? Can we this, can we that? But it was, it was a big difference. Yeah,
we just talking about the situation.
These stories. See, this is part of our history. People say to me, it's all about the music. I say it's not just about the music, because the music was a major part of it. But the music is what brought the people together.
That's right.
Fats Domino said.
That's right.
Fats Domino said, my music can do more than a court order from a judge.
Right.
It can do more than the National Guard.
Right.
My music can bring people together, and that's what he did,
right,
and that's what your music did too.
Right.
So these same people who wouldn't serve you because of the color of your skin bought tickets to your concert because they love the music.
Right.
And that, in its own way, did help break down that barrier.
Yeah. We won the Sam Cooke tours too, a lot of them.
Yeah.
And we were pulling in front of a Coliseum, and it says Sam Cooke Review, Colored Dancing, White Spectators.
Yeah.
And what had happened, they would have the railings cartoned off so the blacks didn't get upstairs, and all the white people, you know, were looking down at it, and all the, you know, colored.
They wanted to come down during the party.
They wouldn't allow it.
Fats Domino also said that the concept of a concert was created for his music because the white kids and the Negro kids would be dancing together, and they didn't want that, especially in the South.
Right.
So what they would do is saying, this is not a dance. You have to sit, and you sit where we tell you to sit. The white kids will sit up in the balcony.
The Negro kids
will sit down on the floor, down on the main floor, and you can't be with each other.
But he
said, my music brought them all together.
My music,
and your music did that too.
That's
why I think this is so important, because of what you contributed to American history and to civil rights. That's why you guys got to be so proud to be standing here in front of American Bandstand and to be telling your story.
And another thing, we were down in Dallas, Texas when the president got assassinated.
Wait a minute. You were on the show with the Chabans.
Right.
They were on that show.
Right.
They were there.
Right.
The
Ronettes.
The Ronettes were there.
Yeah.
Bobby D was there.
Right. Yeah, That's right.
And who? Bobby
Gene Pitney.
Brian Hyland was there.
Gene Pitney.
And Gene Pitney was there too.
Because when it happens,
Crystal's
there. And Gene Pitney, he came to my room and he said, CZ, he said, let's go downstairs and watch the president come in.
Did you watch the parade?
We were on our way to the parade.
Yeah.
But as we were on our way down, the president had got assassinated.
Yeah.
And I called home to tell them that what had happened, but it hadn't hit Philadelphia yet.
Yeah.
But Gene Pitney and I were on our way down to go to the parade to see the president come in. And we stayed at the hotel, and at the end of the block.
Which hotel?
I forgot the name of the hotel. And right down the street was the jail where they kept Oswald.
We left
there, the hotel, past the jail, going to Kentucky. And when we got to Kentucky, we heard that Oswald had got assassinated. We were right there. And that night, before the concert didn't go on.
The concert was canceled.
But our lead singer, George Williams, got sick that night. And they had to take him to the same hospital that the president was
in. Parkland Hospital.
No, in the emergency, the same cubicle.
Right.
Emergency cubicle.
There was still blood on the floor.
Yeah, same one, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right, really?
Yeah. And
really?
The reason why I had to take him, he jumped me playing around. We were wrestling.
He lost his breath.
I got a call and said, Norm, you got to get George to the hospital. I said, what's wrong? He said, can't breathe. So that's when we had to get the emergency.
Yeah. There's a lot of stories.
Wait. This is great. This is fantastic. I don't know why I didn't know you were on that on that concert.
Yeah. Well, a lot of people didn't know.
I remembered Bobby V being on there and Brian Hyland.
Right.
And they went down to see. They were a little bit ahead of you.
Right.
They went down to see the parade.
Right.
You didn't make it to the parade.
We didn't make it. I didn't make it. That's it. But I was on our way down. And the people on the elevator, they said, something happened in the streets. I said, well, the president just got assassinated. They looked at me like, are you for real? Yeah, you know, yeah. Come on. And when they got down on the street, they found out what had happened. But we didn't make it to the parade.
But
really.
Let me tell you, that night, it was like a ghost town.
Believe it, yeah.
One liquor store was
everybody was in that liquor store. Mm-hmm. And the gentleman that shot Oswald, he had a club across the street, Jack Ruby. He had a club across the street from the hotel.
Then you stayed at the Adolphus Hotel.
Adolphus, that's it,
You stayed at the Adolphus.
That's it.
You know your stuff.
That's it.
You just ain't a pretty face.
But it was interesting. It was.
It was interesting, though.
Really, a lot. You know, and that was one sad day. But like I said, we took George to the hospital that night, and still seeing the droppings of blood on the floor. Man, that was like. Yeah. We're part of history.
Well, you were with them. You were there.
And we were with them, that was part of history, man. I mean, you know, that's it. It was deep.
I'm getting chills.
Hey, man. It was something. Believe me.
This is why you guys are so important. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that you were on that concert, but this is why I came to Philadelphia.
If those people that seen the movie, the Temptations movie, and when they stopped the bus in the middle of the highway, that was very true. That's the kind of stuff you went through when you went down south. Yeah. They loved the music, but we did a show one time where they had the whites on one side, the blacks on the other side, and something happened and all the white section left.
At one of your concerts?
At one of the concerts, So all the white section left.
There were many places in the south where white performers would not perform.
Mm-hmm. Right, right.
In Augusta, in Columbus, Georgia.
Right.
Mm-hmm. In Chattanooga, Tennessee. Mm-hmm. A lot of places where there was too much animosity, so the whites said, if they're going to treat the Negro performers this way, we're not going on either. Mm-hmm.
Right, there you
go. So, everybody, there you go. See, the music brought everybody together. That's why it's so important.
That's
why I'm doing what I'm doing.
Thank you very much for that.
It's not just this jockey. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's thousands of this jockeys who have been around doing this for decades. Mm-hmm. That's not what I'm about. That's not my purpose. Mm-hmm. My purpose is to put the history out there against the backdrop of this great music. Mm-hmm. And if you guys hadn't been singing, you'd have never been down south.
Right.
You would have never experienced that. Right. You never would have known that was happening to other young men just like you, only down in Birmingham.
Right. A lot of people are afraid to tell stories like that, but I mean, if it happened, it happened.
It's so important so that we don't let that kind of a thing ever happen again.
That's why this is so important.
There was a song in 1974 that you guys sang that basically ushered in the disco era.
Right.
Tell me about that. What song was that?
You Little Trust Me.
Right.
Where did that song come from?
Don't know. We don't know what a trust me is.
Right. I think but Billy Jackson brought that to us. And there's a story behind that. They gave it to us to sing, and George went in and sang it, but George sang it too pretty. You know, he had that beautiful voice. And so the actual lead singer on that song is our producer, Billy Jackson.
He said, this is the way I want you guys to sing it.
Right, and he did it, and we liked it. We liked it, that was it.
And I know Jimmy sings it on stage now.
He does a
great job. Mm-hmm. And you would almost think that Jimmy did it back then.
That's it. But that's the story behind it.
So after he sang that song, you guys said, okay, George, now do that, or George, you can't do that.
Well, when Billy heard the playback, when we all heard the playback, it was like, that don't sound bad, you know, but George was singing like, you little trust maker. You know, Billy was, you little trust maker.
Yeah.
You know, how, and that's what he wanted. That's what we got. We got a hit. That's what happened, you know.
I enjoy that song.
Yeah,
I enjoy watching you guys perform that thing on stage because you go from that smooth 1963 all of a sudden to 1974. And everybody really jumps out of their chairs. It's a moving song.
Yeah.
And disco kind of followed that, but they went down a smoother path. You know, and
it
really sounds like something that the Spinners might have done.
Yeah, a lot of people didn't believe it was us at the time either. Really.
When they hear it,
We had a lot of fun with it. We still have a lot of fun with it.
Oh, yeah. You
know? And we still have a lot of fun with this business. We love the business.
In fact, you guys drive around in a car that has an unusual license plate, right?
Right on.
That's got so much fun.
Mm-hmm. You know that one?
Yeah, yeah. That was tough. Yeah. Yeah, get out of here. Da 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 da. Okay.
That's not Philadelphia. Okay. See, okay. Philadelphia had a little different tune.
Yes, yes, there, yeah, there yeah, was yeah, a Philly yeah,
really
soul.
And the Penguin was West Coast.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
see, the him Penguin, they West Coast
mm-hmm,
guys
mm-hmm,
singing.
Mm-hmm,
South
mm-hmm.
didn't have too much of the doo-wop doo.
Right, 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 right.
We
did a lot
of the Penguins, too.
Right, yeah.
But my favorite group was the...
Spaniels?
Yeah, oh yeah, the Spaniards.
Pookie,
no,
yeah.
No, no, the Hop Tongues.
Hop Tongues, yeah, yeah,
Sunday
yeah,
kind
yeah,
of love.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah, we used to see, yeah, we used to see that on the corner. We used to see that on the corner.
Okay.
Let me see.
I'm
through with my whole love. I love her through and through. I'm searching for a new love. Can that new love be you? I want a Sunday kind of love.
Not for y'all, them. Y'all young people.
They don't know nothing about that.
I know.
They don't know about that.
See, they don't know. Oh, God. That was a good
They also sang Since I Fell for You.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, mm-hmm. yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, they did it mm-hmm. after.
Not a group.
Ella Johnson did it.
Mm-hmm.
Her, her brother Buddy wrote Ooh, it for her.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
She sang it in front of the Buddy Johnson Orchestra.
Yes.
And then they came along, they did it, and then Lenny Welsh did it in the mm-hmm. same year, 63, mm-hmm. as a matter of fact.
Mm-hmm.
At the very mm-hmm. end of 63, right. after mm-hmm. the assassination, mm-hmm. he was mm-hmm. getting ready to sing that
yep,
too.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's
right.
Hey, man, they don't do that no more.
But I was just upset that we never could get another generation
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
to do doo-wop again.
But mm-hmm. it's going to happen.
On the stand on
it's
the corner.
It's going to happen. Yeah.
Well,
but they're doing, but they're doing it now.
See, now we're growing about 40 or 50 years.
Mm-hmm.
This music is coming back around.
They're doing it now on the acapella shows.
It's going to.
Right.
You know, the doo-wop. Because a lot of the groups came along. Now, the Temptation wasn't quite the doo-wop.
No. What was it like 50 years ago for you young kids, you young Philadelphia singers, to be on national TV? Now, Dick Clark stood right here.
Right.
And this was what?
The Raider record.
And what was that?
That was when they put a record on. Well, when your record came in, Dick Clark would put it on and say, I want you kids to rate this record.
Right.
And they would listen to it, dance to it. And some of them used to say, well, I like the beat, I like the lyrics or whatever. But when it was on Bandstand, it was rated, it was a hit. Believe me.
It's called Make or Break It.
Make it or Break It. That's
you
right.
You guys were made.
Right, on here. Right here. That's right. That's right.
So much in love.
That's right.
Wonderful, wonderful.
Right, that's right.
Later that year.
Somewhere. That's right.
It was all launched really from right here.
Right, that's right. Yeah. Dick Clark was the man that made it possible.
So tell me about this room now. This is where Dick Clark's podium
right.
was. It was over here.
Right, yeah. right.
Okay? Mm-hmm. This is where he appeared on TV,
mm-hmm.
and the cameras were set up
mm-hmm.
just yeah. off in front of him.
I think the stands were hit over
stands,
here.
That's where the kids
right, the kids
sat,
would
over
sit.
Here.
Right, right. And as he introduced you, there was a curtain, like a sparkly curtain, and either you came out or you were standing in front of it.
So you either came out from behind the curtain.
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
Or you stood in front.
Or you stood in front of it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Lip sync at that time.
Why did you guys bring me over to this side of the room?
This is the place where the curtain was that hung, and this is where all the acts stood when they were recording on American Bandstand.
So the curtain hung right here.
Right, right. That's right. You were against the wall,
yeah.
and either you would come out singing,
or else you would. Later,
right. Or else you would stand there. Yeah, yeah, yeah. This was it. This was
now,
the place.
I can remember being 9 years old,
mm-hmm.
watching Little Anthony and the
mm-hmm.
Imperials,
mm-hmm.
standing here,
mm-hmm.
singing, and Little Anthony with the drama.
Mm-hmm.
Tears on my pillow.
Tears on my pillow.
My father would walk in after work. He was a construction worker. Turn that thing off.
Yeah.
Get outside. Play baseball.
Yeah.
Do something.
Yeah.
Don't be sitting down there
yeah.
watching
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
We were 9 years old.
Yeah, yeah. Caused by you.
Right here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah, this was the good stuff, man.
It happened in what, 62?
Good stuff, yeah.
Little Anthony, Tears on My Pillow was 58.
1958, yeah.
1958,
yeah.
I was
yeah.
9 years old.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay,
yeah.
sitting downstairs in the rec room on a
so
black and white
back
TV.
To,
mm-hmm.
not Charles, but he remember probably. Annie had a little baby.
Ooh, yeah.
Remember that?
Hank Bowden and Midlighters. Annie had a baby.
Oh, my.
Can't work.
They wanted to ban that song.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh,
that's
compared right. to what you stuff you hear now on
that's
TV.
Right. That's
to
right.
think that in them days.
Right, that's it.
That
that's
was kind of shaky.
That's it. You yeah. can feel, you actually feel something.
Can't you?
You know what I'm saying?
Can't you
you, you
it's
feel.
A draft. It's a draft.
Yeah, yeah. Don't you feel something?
Next
you really
time,
do. You know,
you, really you do feel.
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. you have, yeah. I always say that our emotions don't get old.
Mm-hmm.
You have the same emotions you
mm-hmm.
did 49 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
You sit there and you look at that audience,
mm-hmm.
okay?
And you imagine what was here, how it was set up.
Well, you don't, I can
everything.
Imagine. You don't
mm-hmm.
have to imagine.
Yeah, yeah.
You just
got to
remember.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
you were here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Little did you know the impact it was having on people around the
right.
nation. But we were all glued to that TV
mm-hmm.
set.
That's
because
right.
you guys were on.
Yeah, yeah.
That's right. Us and every artist that came out of Philadelphia, if you didn't make American Bandstand.
Well, you weren't coming out of Philadelphia if
right.
you didn't get out of American Bandstand.
That's right.
You
were right.
going to go back to your high school, back
right.
to your college, back
that's
to whatever
right.
you were doing back then.
Right.
And you were done.
So I can say it's thank you, Dick Clark.
Now, you showed me a money clip once.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I still have
it. Matter of fact, he showed it to us a couple of days ago.
Yeah.
Really. We was in there. He said, I bet you don't have one of these.
Yeah.
And I looked.
Yeah.
I said, hey, man.
Yeah,
yeah,
some money,
really.
Man.
Yeah.
Well, it only had a dollar bill in it, so
no.
it's one single dollar. But you showed me. Now, tell me about that money clip. What was that?
Well, what happened at the end of the tour?
Mm-hmm.
Dick Clark would give us little gifts, you know. So he
mm-hmm.
gave us a tape, a reel-to-reel of the
mm-hmm.
of the parties.
Right.
And he gave us a money clip. Said, "Thanks, Dick Clark."
Mm-hmm.
You
know, with his signature engraved.
Right.
There we
yeah.
go. The podium.
The curtain and everything.
Yeah, the podium, the curtain.
It's right there. Yeah.
Right. If you're looking at it, the podium was probably here, the curtain there, the dancers out here, and the stands over there.
Yeah.
That's just the way it was.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, y'all had it right.
That's it. Damn, let's look at it. That's it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You see where they stretched out at all over here, dancing. And when he would be on the podium, he would say, here, bam, and you come out that curtain. That's it. Yeah. Come from behind the curtain, you hear the bird. As we stroll along.
Did you sing live?
No, lip sync. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Everybody.
All lip syncing.
Mm-hmm.
All
lip
sync.
Lip sync.
That's right.
Easy.
Everybody
yeah.
came
yeah.
on,
and,
you know.
And inexpensive.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
But when you did the shows.
Oh, on the concert performance.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Now, remember he had the beach nut. Hour. Remember that he had that for 2 years.
Yeah, on Saturday
mm-hmm.
night.
Mm-hmm. Saturday 58-59, mm-hmm. I think that
mm-hmm.
was. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
that went on for 2 years.
Yeah.
We did go out to California to film, but I wasn't with him at
no.
the time. Soul Train
and
Dick Clark Show and Bandstand, yeah. Yeah, because you did them. And because a lot of people didn't know, when you seen the same people every day, each day, each weekend rather, so you would take one show. Then you would take. Then somebody else would come in that day, and that day next time. But the four shows, you follow what I'm saying?
Oh, you would tape four shows. The entire week on one day,
yeah.
And then they divide it up. Into
right.
Yeah.
And the same people would be on there in the same clothes, and you're like, wait
yeah.
a minute, wasn't there this on the show?
Yeah.
You know. But each week it was a different show.
Yeah.
So we tape. Well, I wasn't with them. Like I said, Bandstand, and you tape Soul Train the same day. You know? Yeah. 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 Yeah,
big production.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, but this is the spot.
1963, the number one record throughout the nation is So Much in Love. Here are the Tymes.
As we stroll along together, holding hands, walking all alone. So in love.
I love it.
Are
it's good.
We too?
I love it. No.
But I'm actually the first tenor, he's a baritone.
Yeah.
Believe me, I got chills standing here knowing what.
And again, like I said, thank you, Dick Clark. You know, this is where it all started.
What was it, what was it like at the Apollo?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'll tell you one funny story. When we were there with Moms Mabley, Ruby and the Romantics, and Brooke Benton. And when we first went, see a lot of people, you know, we never prepared. We didn't know what preparation was to go on stage. So we got out on the stage and we saw one mic. And all of us got around this one mic, and the band is playing Broadway, on Broadway, right? The vampiness. And we saw one mic, and we're all standing there like, what's going on? You know, the band is playing, the crowd is booing, we're not singing. So I'm standing all the way over here, and all of a sudden my foot start moving, right? And come to find the guys backstage are saying, move back, move back. And come to find out, when I moved back, a microphone came up from out of the floor. Scared us to death. We stand on the stage, still haven't sang a word. The crowd, get them off there, boo. The guy came out with the hook.
But when the mics came up.
It was only one mic, but this one was a lead mic. Yeah. You know, no, it was a group mic. It was about this big. And it came up out the floor because they had to pull a rope. And that's why my foot was moving, and I'm standing on top of the little disc where the thing had to come out of. And I'm standing there, and I'm like, hey, move back. And all of a sudden, this thing comes flying up out the floor, and we're standing there, and we still haven't sang. The band has played about 16 bars.
That was the mic that all of you guys were going to
sing. That was the group mic. But we were all standing on this one mic. We thought that was the group mic, but that was the lead mic.
Oh,
that was weird, man.
But did you get it together and say?
Oh yeah, we got it together.
The crowd loved you. Yeah.
The guy came back. What was his name? The dancer. Wasn't it the dancer?
Honey Coles.
Honey Coles.
Yeah, he came up to the dressing room and he says, "Hey, man, the Drifters just left here." He said, "I think you guys better take that song out of your repertoire." Yeah. And we opened up with Black Magic.
Turn on your love light.
Oh, Lord.
That was horrible.
You know, you get booed off the stage at the Apollo Theater, brother.
Was this before you guys were?
No.
This is when we had a hit record.
Yeah, really? But the reason why it happened, we were recording all week.
Yeah, yeah.
We couldn't go up to rehearse.
Mm-hmm,
we didn't know the layout of the Apollo.
Mm-hmm,
When we got up there, we just went on there cold.
Just went on there. And didn't know
nobody
what.
Nobody said nothing.
Nobody said to watch out for the mic or whatever. Didn't know nothing.
But after that, it was cool.
Yeah, after that, it was cool. We stayed at the Teresa Hotel. Yeah. Lord have mercy.
Oh, yeah.
Fidel Castro was there, too.
Fidel Castro was there. We were there at the time, yeah. He had the whole top floor.
Well, the same week you were there.
Yeah. Oh, we had some experiences, man.
So the kids would line up here, and they'd come in this door.
And this was here, I'm back on here. This is all the original building, original doors and everything.
Now this is amazing. We just retraced the steps for the kids who come into the American Bandstand. When the kids just walk through this door, they go out on the dance floor, and if this door opens up, we're gonna walk through this door. And it's just like all these young kids did back in 1957, 58, 59, just like it was on TV, nationally televised. This gentleman is Roland. Now Roland is in charge of this museum, of this property here in 2012. And Roland was so nice to give us this tour. I appreciate it, buddy. I appreciate all you've done for us, taking us through the front door, the back door, the side door, and the stage door of Dick Clark's American Bandstand.
He was one of the
Roland and Dick Clark.